Good evening, everybody. I think we can say a little bit louder. Good evening. Yeah. We are grateful to be here tonight, and we know where two or three are in the Lord's midst, He is with us. And yeah, we want to come before Him and bring Him the adoration He deserves by singing the following songs. And I encourage you to sing with us and support us by doing this. Amen. The first song we're going to sing is How Great Thou Art. But I think we can also start maybe without the lyrics first. No way here.
How great thou art, dancing's my soul.
next song we're going to sing is Blessed Assurance, Jesus is Mine.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, brothers and sisters. Good evening, and welcome today to our fourth day in this series that we're having on the truth. We currently, already finished topics on truths about the kingdoms of this world, truths about the future, truths about God's law. And I don't know about you, but I've been so blessed to learn about these truths from the Bible and the way it is brought about, not just from one verse or one aspect of the Bible, but from cover to cover. And that is really been insightful and really being easy to understand, right? So today is no exception, and I can't wait to hear what God has to share through his servant, Elder Douglas, on the topic of baptism. Today we studied the topic, the truth about baptism. So before we go into today's topic, I would like to invite you all to stand as we have a word of prayer. Almighty God and everlasting Father, we thank you so much for this week that we could come and study your word, that we can learn about your truths, dear Father. We pray that you would continue to be with us now as we open up your word again, that your Holy Spirit will come and be our teacher and our guide. We ask that you would use Elder Douglas in a mighty way. Help him, dear Father, to speak your words. We pray also for all of us that are listening that the messages that will come will be easy, will be plain, that we will be able to understand every word that comes from your word, the Bible. We pray also for those that are still on their way. We ask, dear Father, that you bring them here safely. We pray for those that are watching online, dear Father, that they may also have this experience that we are having. We pray now in Jesus' mighty and precious name. Amen. I'll now invite the choristers to lead out in the theme song for this week.
Stand up and join us while singing the theme song.
Good evening. This is question time. I want to encourage you to write your questions on the little sheet of paper, I believe we have at the end, and also You can online submit a question. The QR code will be displayed. We have one question for Paul to answer tonight. And this came with a little comment. I commit a lot of sins. Will I get into heaven? I'm interested in this question because I commit some sins, I believe, sometimes.
I commit a lot of sins all the time. It's not just you, Pastor Tibor. That's a very good question. If I commit a lot of sins, will I get into heaven? And what have we been doing all week? We have been looking for truth where? In the Bible. That's the only place of truth and the standard of truth. So I'm going to ask you to turn with me to 1 John, the book of 1 John, chapter 1 and verse 8. And we're going to see what that says. 1 John, chapter 1 and verse 8. I'm trying to at least make sure this thing comes up here. It's not showing right now. 1 John chapter 1 and verse 8. And let us read what it says. If we say that we have no sins, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. So I am a sinner. I have sinned. Pastor Tibor has also admitted that he is a sinner and he's also sinned. But what does verse 9 say? If we confess our sins, he being God is faithful and he is just to forgive us of all our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. So the question again was, if I commit a lot of sins, can I go to heaven? The answer is yes. The answer is yes. The answer is yes. And the reason being, the Bible says if we confess our sins, he is faithful and he is just to forgive us from all our sins. I even actually want to go a little bit further. Yesterday, a young person actually came to me and said, well, I have a lot of sins. I'm worried about going to heaven. And I spoke to that young lady and I said, well, first of all, stop worrying. There's no need to worry. And I led her to a passage in Luke chapter 15. And when you go home tonight, read in Luke chapter 15 the stories that Jesus told. He told three parables, one about the lost sheep, one about the lost coin, and the other about the lost son. And here's what I'd like to say to you, as I said to her. It is actually hard to be lost. It is actually hard to be lost. Let's look at the story. The lost sheep. There were 100 sheep and one went astray. The Savior, the shepherd, left 99 of those sheep and went after that single one. Left the 99 and went after that single sheep. Then he told the story of the lost coin. A lady has 10 coins in her house and she's lost a coin and she cannot find the coin. And then she is sweeping in the house and then finds that coin that was lost. So here is a person who may already be in church, may already call themselves a Christian and not even realize that they are lost. They are in the house already and are actually lost. But yet God, in his love, goes and sweeps up that house and looks for that coin. My dear friends, it's actually hard to be lost. And then the third and final story of Luke chapter 15, as he talks about this lost son. A son who goes to his father and says, listen, I want my share of the inheritance. He takes his share of the inheritance and he goes on a journey to a far country. He spends all of his money in riotous living and he loses all of this money and he ends up with pigs. He ends up in the dirt of pigs. And one day he comes to his senses and says, I will go back to my father's house. I'll go back to my father's house and just be one of his hired servants. And as he's making his way back to his father's house, and he turned that corner on his way home, the father runs out to meet him, covers him with his robe, put a ring on him, and carries him back into the house. That means the father was looking all along for his son. And once he saw that son make that turn of repentance and come towards home, he closed the distance from where the home was to where his son was. My dear friends, it is hard to be lost. Very hard to be lost. And tonight, we will unpack a little bit more related to this question about if I sin, can I get to heaven? The answer is yes. It could be one sin. It could be 10 sins. It could be 100 sins, 1,000 sins, no matter the amount. If we confess them to God, He is faithful, He is just to forgive us of these sins and to cleanse us like we had never even sinned. Let us pray together as we look tonight on the truth about baptism. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you that we have come once again to look into your word to find truth. Open our minds that we might hear. Open our hearts that we might believe. Thank you, O God, for the truth and the trustworthiness of your word. And be with us now as we open your word. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Let me try this, Elder. Good evening, everyone. Better than last night. We're doing better, so let's try it one more time. Good evening, everyone. Yes, and for those of you who are online, I would hope that in your homes or wherever you are shouting out loudly, good evening as well. Now, we're seeming to have a little bit of technical difficulty, and we're going to try to solve that just now because on the screen, you're not seeing what I have on my screen. So let's try this again, Edward. It has worked every single night, but you know the devil doesn't want us to hear God's word. Is that all right? We know that, but we're going to overcome that just now. Well, still not working. What did we do tonight that we didn't do all the other nights? It tells me that stage manager is on. I've never seen that before. Can we take that off? And Well, here's what we're going to do. We'll go without it on the screen. Is that okay with you? That's okay? No, that's okay. All right, so we're going to talk about the truth about baptism. And the last couple of nights, what have I done? We have done a recap. Is that okay to do a recap? On the first night, we talked about four kingdoms. And what were those four kingdoms? I'm sure you have your notes. First kingdom was? The second kingdom was? The third kingdom was? Greece. And the fourth kingdom was? Rome. And then there was not a fifth kingdom, but there was a divided Europe as represented by the feet of iron and clay. But then there was a stone that came from where? The mountain. It was carved out of the mountain, and it crushed all of the kingdoms before it. And then Jesus Christ himself set up his kingdom. And we found that in Daniel chapter 2, verse 44. The God of heaven will set up a kingdom which will what? Never be destroyed. It will be an everlasting kingdom, an eternal kingdom, God's kingdom, and our kingdom with our God. The God of heaven will set up a kingdom which will never be destroyed. Then on the second night, we talked about the anxieties that people are having all over this world. Every nation, every country, every people group, boy and girl, man and woman, having anxieties of what will happen tomorrow. What will happen next week? What will happen next month? What will happen next year? What will happen even in the next hour? And we found as persons are very concerned in their life today, all around us, God gave us in Matthew 24 the various signs that would happen just before he would come. We don't know when he will come, but we know he comes quickly. And we know the signs of how soon he will come. And these signs are being fulfilled. Signs in the religious world, signs in the political world, signs in the world of nature, and signs in the world of social activities and society today. And last night, we talked about God's law in the midst of it all being the standard by which judgment would be made. It's a standard and the basis of morality, and it's a standard of judgment. And God's law was written by him. God's law was written by him in stones as given to the Israelites and given to the nation of this world when he wrote them in the Mount of Sinai. And we learned last night that if we love God, and by the way, God loved us first, but we learned last night that if we love God, we would do what? We would keep his commandments. How many of them? Just one or two? All of them. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Love leads us to obedience. So if we love God, we would keep all of his commandments. And we also learned last night that as part of this last days before Jesus will come again, there will be a people. There will be a people who will have his law, God's law, written in their hearts and written on their minds, putting away the things of the past and living in accordance to the will that God has set out for them. Truly, I want to be a part of those people who have God's law written on their minds and also written on their hearts. So, my friends, we are coming to a time in Earth's history that a choice has to be made. A choice has to be made. We either love God or we do not love God. There's no place in the middle. I love him, almost don't love him. You either love God or you do not love God. So God is calling on everyone, on you and on me, to take a very public stand as to where we stand with God. Do you love him or do you not love him? So tonight we are going to talk about how we indeed make this stand. How do we indeed take a stand for God? And where are we going to find it, my friends? Where have we found all truths these past four nights? Where have we found the truth? In the Bible. And what have we said together? If it's in the Bible, I believe it. If it disagrees with the Bible, it's not for me. Again, if it's in the Bible, I believe it. If it's not in the Bible, if it disagrees with the Bible, it's not for me. So tonight, as we have every night, I'm going to ask you, those of you who are here and those of you who are online, to write down these passages. I will give you the name of the passage, and if by chance we're able to get these on the screen tonight, so be it. But if not, write down these passages. I'll read to you what these passages say as we go through God's Word to find out how do we make a stand. How do we make a stand? The first passage, Revelation chapter 22 and verse 17. Revelation chapter 22 and verse 17. We're going to do something differently tonight. If you find that passage, why don't you read that passage? Revelation chapter 22 and verse 17. Let's all get involved tonight. Revelation chapter 22 and verse 17. Who has that passage? And read it out loudly. And anyone? Well, here's what we could do. Somebody will just take the microphone so those who are online can also hear you. And we're going to at least participate together. Since we have no screen, we will be the screen. Is that okay? Amen. Revelation chapter 22 and verse 17. The red mic. Are we together?
And the Spirit and the Bride say, come. And let him that heareth say, come. And let him that is athirst come. And whosoever will, let him take the water of life freely.
Okay, so whosoever will, let him take the water of life freely. Freely. Okay, the next one. Revelation chapter 1, verses 5 and 6. Whoever has that one, read that one. Revelation chapter 1, verses 5 and 6.
And from Jesus Christ, who is the faithful witness, and the first begotten of the dead, and the prince of the kings of the earth, unto him that loved us and washed us from our sins in his own blood.
Okay, so the first one we said, whoever will, let him take the water of life freely. And then in this one, Revelation chapter 1, verses 5 and 6, it says, to him, being God, who loved us and did what? Washed us from our sins in his own blood. In his own blood. So baptism, my friends, is a symbol of our commitment and loyalty and allegiance to Jesus Christ. That's what we're talking about tonight. The truth about baptism as to how then we cleanse ourselves, put away the past sins, put away the past life, and then stand for Jesus Christ and express in a public way our loyalty, our commitment, and our allegiance to Jesus Christ. So someone else, Matthew 28, verses 19 and 20. Matthew 28, verses 19 and 20. Anyone, just jump out, start speaking, an elder will come with the microphone so you can be heard online. Matthew chapter 28, verses 19 and 20. We're doing it together. We are going to be the screen tonight. Sometimes technology is good. Sometimes technology doesn't work. But we're okay because we are together. Is that all right? And for those of you online, we will give you the text as well. You look it up and you'll read it right where you are. Matthew chapter 28, 19 and 20. We're talking tonight about the truth about baptism, freely given, and also God who washes us from our sins in his own blood.
Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you. And behold, I am with you always to the end of the age.
Amen. So go ye therefore and make disciples of how many nations? All nations. Doing what with them? Baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. It goes on to then say, teaching them to do what? Observe all the things that I've commanded you, all the things that I've taught you. And lo, I am with you always, even until the end of the age. And it says, amen. So, my dear friends, when we are baptized, we declare our allegiance, we take a public stand, we show whose side we are on. Do we love God or do we not love God? No ground in the middle. So the apostles and the disciples, when they were given this commission from Jesus Christ, were taught to go make other disciples, to tell about all that they had learned, but not only what they had learned, but to baptize them so they could take a public stand, indicating that they believed and also wanted to be on the Lord's side. So my friends, and I wish you had the pictures here that you could see, but just imagine in the mind's eye. There are different types of baptisms that have happened over the ages, but there are many that are false, and there's one that is true. Many that are false and one that is true. There are in some churches where they will take babies and sprinkle them with water and call that baptism. They are in some churches, they will actually take a newborn, a very young baby, and take a bucket of water or a pail of water and pour all of that water on that baby. They're in some churches that they will have the person just lay down in some petals of roses and sprinkle them with fine fragrances and oils and call that baptism. We also learned not too long ago that some young persons went on a camp and they were in the mountains in the snow, and the person there said, well, just lie down in the snow and cover yourself with the snow, and that could be part of your baptism. But I want somebody to read Ephesians chapter 4 and verse 5. Ephesians chapter 4 and verse 5, what we're doing here every night is looking to God's word to give us the truth. And tonight we're looking for the truth about baptism. Ephesians chapter 4 and verse 5. Who would like to read that tonight?
One Lord, one faith, one baptism.
One Lord, one faith, one baptism. It did not say one Lord, one faith, many types of baptisms. It says one Lord, one faith, and one baptism. So there is a biblical method. There's a God-ordained method in terms of baptism. And we can find that also in the illustration of how Jesus Christ himself was baptized. How Jesus Christ himself was baptized. So somebody read for me Mark 1, the Gospel of Mark. It's in the New Testament, Matthew, Mark, the second book, Mark 1 and verse 9, as we look now to see how Jesus himself was baptized as an indication as to this one method and true method of baptism. Mark 1 and verse 9.
And it came to pass in those days that Jesus came from Nazareth, Nazareth of Galilee, and was baptized of John in Jordan.
Okay, so it came to pass. So there was a time in those days that Jesus, when he was alive on this earth, he came from Nazareth of Galilee and was baptized by John in the Jordan River. So Matthew 3, verse 16 and 17. Somebody else read that one. Matthew 3, verse 16 and 17. Anyone has that? Matthew 3, verse 16 and 17. We'll take our time tonight. I wish for those who are online, we could find some way to hear you as you look up these passages and you read them in our hearing. But we just trust that where you are finding these passages yourself and you are reading them aloud as well. So Matthew 3, verse 16 and 17, we're talking about the baptism of Jesus.
And Jesus, when he was baptized, went up straight away from the water. And lo, the heavens were opened unto him. And he saw the Spirit of God descending as a dove and coming upon him. And lo, a voice out of the heavens saying, "This is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased."
Okay, so there we have it now. Jesus came up immediately from the water, and behold, the heavens were opened, and he saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove, alighting or resting upon him. And suddenly, a voice from heaven saying, "This is my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased." This passage then suggests that if he came up out of something, he had gone down into something. Is that okay? He descended into the water. He was immersed below the water and came up from the water. That's what the Bible says. We're talking about the truth about baptism, one faith, one Lord, one method of baptism. So here's a point that we need to understand. First point, the Holy Spirit descended upon Jesus to give him supernatural power to face temptation. So after he has been baptized, this Holy Spirit descends upon him to give him supernatural power to be able to face temptation. So that would suggest that just because a person is baptized, just because a person gives their heart and their mind and their life to Christ, that they don't become automatically perfect. Okay? It does not mean that they will no longer have temptation. It does not mean they will not fall into sin. It does mean, though, that the person has the power with which to face that temptation and in time overcome that temptation. The Holy Spirit descended upon Jesus and gave him supernatural power to face temptation. Somebody read Acts chapter 10 and verse 38. It points this out in terms of the anointing of Jesus Christ after his baptism. Acts chapter 10 and verse 8. Who has that? Pastor Tibor, go ahead.
Who God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and with power, who went about doing good and healing all who were oppressed by the devil.
So Jesus was baptized. He came from Nazareth of Galilee, was baptized by John in the Jordan River. He came up out of that river. That means he had gone down and been immersed below the water, came up out of that river, and he was anointed by God with the Holy Spirit and with power so he could face temptation. The Holy Spirit descended upon Jesus to give him supernatural power to face temptation. That same supernatural power that was available to Jesus is available to you and to me. Somebody should say amen. That same power available to Jesus is also available to you and to me. Then number two, in this passage, it says, the Father spoke to him from heaven. Somebody read Matthew chapter 3 and verse 17. The Father spoke to him from heaven. Okay, he descended, alighted, and rested upon his shoulder, gave him Holy Spirit power, but he also spoke to him from heaven. Matthew 3 and verse 17. What does that say?
And suddenly a voice came from heaven saying, "This is my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased."
So the Holy Spirit rested on him in the form of a dove, gave him power. He also heard from heaven, from his Father, "This is my what? Beloved Son in whom I am well pleased." So Jesus Christ, born and came now to Nazareth from Galilee, and he comes to John, who baptizes him in the Jordan. He comes up out of the Jordan. That means he had gone down into the Jordan, and he now is raised up. He now receives from God power through the Holy Spirit to face any temptation. And if you continue in that Matthew verse and read on, you'll recognize he came up and did face many temptations. But he had the power to resist and to overcome those temptations. He not only had the power through the Holy Spirit, he also had the pleasure of his God, his Father. This is my Son, in whom I am well pleased. My dear friends, the same power that Jesus received after his baptism, the same pleasure of God that Jesus received from his Father is the same we can have today. Won't you say amen? So believers throughout the centuries have experienced this joy as they make and have made a full commitment to Jesus Christ in baptism. The time is coming and the time is here that there needs to be a public stand. Do you love God or do you not love God? There is no middle ground. A public stand, a declarative stand. I have allegiance with Christ, and just like him, I will go down into that watery grave of baptism, putting to death my past and rising to newness of life. Believers down through the ages, here are some of them we read in the Bible of the Ethiopian who read the scripture, and God miraculously led him by Philip down past a river. And the Ethiopian said, I have read, I have studied, I have learned, and I see water. So what hindereth me to be baptized? I have read, I have studied, I believe, I see water. So what hindereth me to be baptized? So Philip took the Ethiopian and went into the water, and right there he baptized him as well. Acts chapter 8, verses 36 through 39. Somebody read that for us. Acts chapter 8. Verses 36 through 39, as we listen and learn through God's word of a person, an Ethiopian, who then has read God's word, has believed God's word, has seen water, and asks, what hinders me from being baptized? Acts chapter 8, verse 36 through 39. Let somebody read that for us tonight.
And as they went on their way, they came unto a certain water. And the eunuch said, see, here is water. What doth hinder me to be baptized? 37. And Philip said, if thou believest with all thine heart, thou mayest. And he answered and said, I believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. And he commanded the chariot to stand still. And they went down both into the water.
And they did what? They went?
Down,
yes.
Mm-hmm. Both into the water, both Philip and the eunuch, and he baptized him. 39. And when they were come up out of the water, the Spirit of God caught away Philip, that the eunuch saw him no more, and he went on his way rejoicing.
So just like Jesus, the Ethiopian went down into something and came up out of something. Jesus went down into the Jordan River, and he came up out of the Jordan River being baptized by John. The Ethiopian went down into this body of water as they passed along the way. He had read God's word. He believed God's word. He saw water, and he said to Philip, what hinders me from being baptized? Philip stops the chariot right there and then and takes him down to that water and baptizes him there. The truth about baptism, my friends, that's our study tonight. The truth about baptism. Here are four truths that we can learn from the very story of the Ethiopian. Truth number one. Write this down. Truth number one. The Ethiopian accepted Christ. Truth number one. The Ethiopian accepted Christ. He read about his word and he read his scriptures. He believed in Jesus Christ. He accepted Jesus Christ as his own personal savior. Truth number one. Truth number two. His baptism indicated he was taking a public stand. A public stand. As I said before, there's no neutral ground. You either love God or you do not love God. And by taking a public stand, by virtue of baptism, you declare to God and to the world, I am on your side. I am on your side. I accept your gift of salvation. I reject my life of my past, and I live by your law. And now I take this public stand in baptism. Then here's the third truth. The Ethiopian and Philip went into the water. Into the water. And truth number four, the Ethiopian was fully immersed. He was placed below the water, being baptized, being put into death, his former life, his past sins, and he was risen in new life with Jesus Christ. Four truths. The Ethiopian accepted Christ. His baptism indicated he was taking a public stand. The Ethiopian and Philip went into the water, and the Ethiopian was fully immersed. We learned before, one faith, one Lord, one baptism, one method, God-ordained method of baptism, which he himself, through his son, Jesus Christ of Nazareth, was buried in that watery grave in Jordan's river. So the truth about baptism, the truths about baptism, we need to accept Christ. And when we accept Christ, we then take and make a public stand. We accept Christ. We take and make a public stand. Then we go to the body of water. Whether it be a river, whether it be an ocean, or whether it be in a baptistry that is in a church, and we are fully immersed below that watery grave and come up in newness of life. Baptism, what does it really mean? It really means to dip, to immerse, to actually plunge beneath the water. That's what it means. And that's an old Greek word, and even in the olden times, the Greek women, as they would try to change the color on a garment that may be of white or a garment of another color, and they tried to change it, they would baptize that garment underneath the new color that they wanted it to take. And for us, my friends, when we are baptized into the blood of Jesus Christ. That changes the color of our sin and make us as white as snow. We are forgiven and we are joined with Christ in a new life with him. So over the centuries, baptisms were actually practiced by immersion. And if I had the opportunity to show you pictures over the centuries where they'll see in various ancient buildings where the baptistry is there in terms of being able to have a person immersed into the water and brought up into the newness of life. In several places around the world, you can find instances or evidences that baptism by immersion was actually the thing to do. And history tells us it was not until around AD 1311 in the 14th century that sprinkling and pouring water over persons was accepted as equally being valid as an immersion form of baptism in the 14th century. But the Bible, the true word of God, the Bible, the trustworthy word of God, the Bible that we have used these past few days to find the truths about certain issues, tells us that there's one faith, one Lord, and one baptism. One faith, one Lord, and one baptism. So I'd like to have somebody now go to Romans chapter 6. Romans chapter 6, verses 3 and 4. This Romans is in the New Testament section of the Bible. After the Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, and Acts, then you will come along to the book of Romans and the 6th chapter, verses 3 and 4. Romans chapter 6, verse 3 and 4. Who would like to read that for us tonight? I really wish we could hear you who are online, but we believe by faith that you are also looking in your Bibles and reading along with us here today. Romans chapter 6, verse 3 and verse 4.
Or don't you know that all of us who were baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death?
Okay. Go ahead.
We were therefore buried with him through baptism into death, in order that, just as Christ was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father, we too may live a new life.
What a beautiful passage as it describes the death of Jesus Christ and what our baptism means. Do you not know that as many of us were baptized into Jesus Christ, we were baptized into his death, the death that he took that was really our death, the cross that he took that was really our cross, the penalty he paid that was really our penalty to pay? Do we not know that as many of us that were baptized into Jesus Christ, we have accepted Jesus Christ, we have taken a public stand for him and our allegiance with him. We so, through his death, we have been buried, and we, through his resurrection, we have come alive in Jesus Christ. What a beautiful passage. So just as Christ was raised from the dead, that physical death that Jesus Christ experienced, that death that he took at the cross of Calvary for our sins, your sins and my sins, when he was raised from the dead, even so, through baptism, when we are put to death for the old life, we are raised to new life in Jesus Christ. Won't you say amen? So, my friends, here's a sequence. There is death, there is burial, and there's resurrection. Death, burial, and resurrection. Death to the old things. Death to the past life. Death to the sins that easily beset us. And being buried in the watery grave of baptism, put into death the former things. And just as Jesus Christ was resurrected, we also, as we come up out of that water, we are resurrected to new life in Jesus Christ. Death, burial, resurrection, new life in Jesus Christ. So baptism, my friends, first thing about baptism, it's dying to the old sinful way. Write this down. If you have your pens or your phones, write this down. Baptism is dying to the old sinful way of life. That's what baptism is. Dying to the old sinful way of life. The past, the pain, the hurts, the things you wanted to do right but you really didn't do right, the sins, dying to that old sinful way of life. That's baptism. Then two, burying those sins in the watery grave. Burying them in the watery grave. And then thirdly, rising up again out of the water to walk in a new life with Jesus Christ. Death, burial, resurrection. Death, burial, and resurrection. Dying to the old sinful way of life, burying our sins in the watery grave, and rising up again. Rising up again out of that water to walk in newness of life. Well, let me quickly say, because somebody might have a question, well, I've been baptized before, but I still might fall into sin. As I said earlier today, baptism doesn't mean you're perfect. Baptism does not mean you're perfect. Baptism means you're committed. Baptism means you have taken a stand, a public stand, to say, I am on the Lord's side. I accept your salvation. I want to put away my past. I want to bury my past. I want to rise in new life in Jesus Christ. It doesn't mean you're perfect, but it means you're committed. It means you are committed. So baptism is not the end of the Christian life. It's not a target to reach. It's the start of a journey. It's the start of a journey with Jesus Christ. It's the beginning with him. Death to the past. Burial of the past. Resurrection to new life. And starting that journey with him. So baptism, my dear friends, gives us this freedom, this new sense of freedom to live a life aligned with God in accordance to his will and waiting and prepared for his soon return, where his children who have made a choice for him, he will say, come, enter into the kingdom that I prepared for you. So baptism, my friends, a new sense of freedom, but also a new spiritual power. New spiritual power. Just like Jesus, as he came up out of the Jordan, the Holy Spirit rested upon him and provided him power to face temptation. Power to face the evil one. Power to overcome. Just like ourselves as well. When we are baptized, we not only have this sense of freedom, but we have the power to overcome and to face temptation. My dear friends, what a beautiful thing to be baptized. What a beautiful gift we get when we are baptized. What a beautiful gift of salvation that God has given to us, because he paid the price that we should have paid. He took the cross that we should have had. And he has given the example. A sinless being as he was, given the example to show what death, burial, and resurrection looks like. So what happens then when we are baptized? Number one, Acts chapter 2 and verse 38. You can look that up when we go home. Acts chapter 2 and verse 38. Every sin is forgiven. Say amen. That's just a beauty. When we are baptized, number one, every sin is forgiven. Acts chapter 2 and verse 38. Then Peter said to them, repent. Turn away. Put away. Repent. Let every one of you be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of your sins. What happens when we're baptized? Every sin is forgiven. What happens when we're baptized? The Spirit is given to us. The power, just like Jesus got when he was baptized, we too receive that power. Mark chapter 1 and verse 10. And immediately, coming up from the water, he saw the heavens parting and the Spirit descending upon him like a dove. The power of God, a gift to Jesus, a gift also to you and to me. My dear friends, when God calls you to baptism, you're cleansed. When God calls you to baptism, you're cleansed, and I am cleansed. And he promises you a gift of his Spirit to empower your life. When God calls you, when God calls you to baptism, you are cleansed. And he promises you a gift. Promises you a gift, the same gift that he gave his son at the Jordan River to empower your life. So number one, what happens when we are baptized? Every sin is, together, forgiven. What happens when we are baptized? The Spirit is given to all of us who are baptized. And number three, what happens when we are baptized? We are adopted. Adopted into God's family. Our sins are forgiven. The Holy Spirit power is given to us, and we are adopted into his family. Acts chapter 2 and verse 41. Then those who gladly received his word were baptized. Those who listened to the Apostle Peter as he spoke, every person at that time, here in their own language. Those who gladly received his word, they were baptized. And that day, about 3,000 souls were added to the group of the believers that were there. What a beautiful gift of God's power. What a beautiful gift of God's presence. What a beautiful gift of God's salvation. What a beautiful gift. And that gift is simply for us to accept it and unwrap it. What a beautiful gift. So when you are baptized, and when I'm baptized, our sins are forgiven, our past life is cleansed, and we receive power. God, today, my friend, are leading thousands of people to accept Jesus Christ as their Savior, to take a public stand for those who love God, as opposed to those who do not love God. There is no middle ground. You're either on God's side or you're not on God's side. And the public declaration of accepting his gift and being loyal to him is demonstrated in taking a public stand in baptism. So what then are the steps to take? Number one step, write this down. The first step, repent. That's the first step. Repent. To understand your life, to recognize that you and I are sinful beings and we have a past life that we want to put away and we're genuinely sorrowful for who we have been and what we have done. Repent. That's the first step. Repentance, my friends, is being sorry enough for my sins that I'm willing to turn away from them and to live a new and different life. So the first step is what? Repent. The second step is to believe. To believe and accept that Jesus is both our Savior and our Lord. Our Savior, the person who paid the penalty for our sin. The Savior who took the cross that was our cross. The Savior who died the death that really was our death. He's both our Savior and our Lord. The person who directs our path. The person who gives us his law for which we, because of our obedience, we would obey. So believe and accept that Jesus Christ is both Savior and Lord. So first step, repent. What's the second step? believe, and then the third step is to learn. Repent, believe, and to learn. Baptism is not the end. It's the beginning of a new life in Jesus Christ. The joy of living with Jesus Christ. It's not the end. So repent, believe, and learn more and more each day about this wonderful Savior, who is Jesus Christ, our Lord. So the steps to baptism, my friend, repent, believe, and then learn. So my friends, tonight, I have just came by here to tell you that God has a wonderful gift of salvation for you and for me. I just came by here to tell you that God loved us first. And he loved us so much, he did not want to be separated from us. So he said, I will send my son to pay the price that they need to pay. I will send my son to take up that cross that they really should take up. I will send my son to die the death that they should die. And I will send my son, who is sinless, to set the example of death, burial, and resurrection. For us also to put to death our past life, to put to death our past sins, to bury them in the watery grave of baptism, and then with Christ to be resurrected into newness of life. What a wonderful gift. Mark chapter 16 and verse 16. Mark chapter 16 and verse 16. He who believes and is baptized will be saved. It's the word of God. All through this week, we have looked to God's word as the standard of truth. Look to this trustworthy, timeless word of God. And here it says, he who believes and is what? Baptized will be saved. John chapter 3 and verse 5, write these texts down. Jesus answered as he spoke to Nicodemus at night, one of the high-ranking leaders of the church in that time. Jesus answered, most assuredly, I say to you, unless one is born of the water and of the Spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God. He who believes in God, he who believes that he sent his son Jesus Christ to be the Savior from our sins, he who believes and is baptized, the same shall be saved. 2 Corinthians chapter 6 and verse 2, and it says as we come to a close, behold, now is the acceptable time. Behold, now is the day of salvation. Not yesterday, not tomorrow, not next week. Behold, now, right now, in this very moment is the acceptable time to take a stand. Now is the time. Now is the time, my friends who are online, to take a public stand, to repent of the past, to believe, and to commit to learning about the joy of living a new life in Jesus Christ. Now is the time to take a public stand, to say, I accept Jesus Christ as my Savior and my Lord. I believe in Jesus Christ and want to be baptized. Now is the time. Not next week. Not next month. Not next year. Now is the time. Because tomorrow could forever be too late. Now is the time. Acts chapter 22 and verse 16. And now, why are you waiting? Why are you waiting? If now is the time, arise and be baptized and wash away your sins and calling on the name of the Lord. My dear friends, we have talked about the truth of the kingdoms of this world. We've talked about the truth about the future. We've talked about the truth about God's law. And tonight we have talked about the truth about baptism. One faith, one Lord, one type of baptism. A baptism that represents our death to the past life. A baptism that represents our death to the old ways of doing things. A baptism that represents the burial of all our past and our sins. A baptism that represents the resurrection to new life in Jesus Christ. My dear friends, some of you may have been searching for truth many years and many months of your lives. And this week you have found some of that truth. Many of you may have been studying for truth. And this week you have had many of your questions answered. Many of you here tonight and online may have been struggling in life and struggling with that decision as to whether to be for Christ or not for Christ, whether to love God or not love God, whether to be on His side or not on His side. I've come to you tonight to appeal to your heart and to appeal to your mind. Now is the time. Now is the time to accept Jesus Christ. Now is the time to believe and to be baptized. Now is the time to put away past life and past sins. Now is the time to bury that in the watery grave. Now is the time to arise with Jesus Christ to new life in Him. And to start that journey of joy and peace and to live with Him forevermore. Now is the time. So, my dear friends, my appeal is simple. My appeal is simple and in two parts. For all those who would like to recommit their lives to the joy of living with Jesus Christ, I'm going to ask you to stand. You have chosen baptism before you. You have already made your public stand for Christ. I'm asking you tonight to recommit yourself to Jesus Christ by standing and saying, Lord, I have believed. Lord, I have accepted. And Lord, I will continue to learn and be with you. But there may be one or two here or online. My appeal to you, having learned the truth about baptism, having learned about the gift of salvation that God has given through His Son for all of us, and you tonight want to say, I want to be baptized. I want to learn more about Jesus Christ. I want to be on his side. If that is your desire, I just want you to raise your hand and I will pray with you tonight. If that is your desire, thank you so much. God be praised. Thank you. God be praised. If that is your desire, just like Jesus Christ, death, burial, resurrection into newness of life. If you're online and you're hearing this appeal, the appeal for commitment, having been baptized before, the appeal for baptism, having not been baptized before, if you are online, at the end of this service, there will be a QR code that you will see. Use that QR code and get in touch with someone here from this church, and they will follow up with you as you repent, believe, and are baptized, and walk into newness of life with Jesus Christ. Heavenly Father, we are just so thankful that you are a God, you are a Father, and you are a friend. And we just want to thank you for the gift that you have given to us through your Son, who took the death that we should have died, who took the cross that was our cross, who took the penalty that was our penalty, and died a death and was resurrected so that we can have life. Even set for us the example of being buried in the watery grave of baptism and arising and receiving from you power to face temptation. Not only power to face temptation, but pleasure from you in what was done. So tonight, we're just so thankful for the two who are here and the others who may be online who have committed themselves to a pathway to being baptized in the name of the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. So seal their commitment tonight. Put a hedge round about them, O God. For the enemy is rampant and would like to dissuade them and discourage them. Put a hedge round about them. And as they walk into this newness of life, heaven will rejoice for another candidate who has come into the kingdom of our Lord. This is our prayer, O God, and we're thankful for being our God. Amen. Amen.
Hallelujah, hallelujah. stretched wide, I will worship you. So I throw up my hands and praise you again and again. 'Cause all that I have is a hallelujah, hallelujah. And I know it's not much, but I got nothing else fit for the King except for a heart singing hallelujah, hallelujah. So come on, my soul, don't you get shy on me, lift up your song, 'cause you've got a lion inside of those lungs. Get up and praise the Lord. I said, come on, my soul, don't you get shy on me, lift up your song, 'cause you've got a lion inside of those lungs. Get up. I said, come on, my soul, don't you get shy on me, lift up your song, 'cause you've got a lion inside of those lungs. Get up and praise the Lord. All that I have is a hallelujah, hallelujah. And I know it's not much, but I got nothing else fit for the King except for a heart singing hallelujah,
amen. We thank God for his message this evening on baptism. We thank God for those two souls that have committed to giving their lives over to Jesus. It's a good time now maybe for me to announce also that we will be having a baptism this coming Saturday, Sabbath, at 3 p.m. For those that are here, but also those that are online. You may be a member, you may be coming to the church for weeks, months, years, and you haven't committed your life yet, but through baptism. Please get in contact with us through the QR code that will be coming up soon. You can reach out on the QR code, but also you can go to our church website. You can find details for the pastor, for the elders, for the church clerk, and you can reach out to anybody from the church in that way. That's it for the announcements. Also, if you would like to have a visitation and a prayer in your homes, Pastor Thibault is still available. His WhatsApp number and email address is on the screen. You can take note of that, and he will make contact with you, or if you contact him, he will visit you. For those that are in the church on site, there will be refreshments, so don't leave. Also, guests, please stay around and have some snacks with us. We will like to get to know you more. That's it. Have a blessed evening.